First of all, I'm going to read from God's Word. And I'm just going to do that, I'm going to take off my glasses. This is from Matthew chapter 9, and it's verses 18 to 26. There's 9 verses. While he, Jesus, was saying these things to them, behold, a ruler came in and knelt before him, saying, my daughter has just died, but come and lay your hand on her, and she will live. And Jesus rose and followed him with his disciples. And behold, a woman who had suffered from a discharge of blood for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his garment. For she said to herself, if I only touch his garment, I'll be made well. Jesus turned and seeing her, he said, take heart, daughter, your faith has made you well. And instantly, the woman was made well. And when Jesus came to the ruler's house and saw the flute players and the crowd making a commotion, he said, go away, for the girl's not dead, but sleeping. And they laughed at him. But when the crowd had been put outside, he went in and took her by the hand, and the girl arose. And the report of this went through all that district. This week, many of you saw a historic sight in the blue, what other colour would it be? The blue skies of Hartlepool. It was on Tuesday, on the underside of the wings of an iconic Supermarine Spitfire aircraft. Did anyone see?
No.
Some, quite a lot of people saw, a lot of people didn't. You could see a message on the underside of the wings of that plane, and it was giving respect and honour for health and healing over the hospital. Ironic, don't you think, that the powerful wings of a killing machine, an efficient dealer of death, were being used for that purpose. It became a symbol of protection. Who could have foresaw that? But back to today. And again, I'm going to take off my glasses. I was pleased to see that today's scripture passage is short. It's only got 9 verses. Now that should or could mean that it's harder to go wrong and I'm more likely to be clear and simple in explaining it. But in another way, it's harder. I also saw that the same passage is covered in Mark with 23 verses from Mark chapter 5 to 22 to 43, and again in Luke with 17 verses from Luke 8, 41 to 56. Put them together and you get the complete story or picture. A three-dimensional one, maybe. Three witnesses to the same events. If this was a documentary, there would be three camera setups and three film crews, and then someone would have to join the three films into one. Well, I'm going to try to weave those three threads into one. You could say, to plait them together. Let me start with Matthew. Last Sunday, we heard that Jesus was a doctor. He was once sent to those who are sick, of course. But that means not the righteous, but sinners, separated from God. So, he's not just a doctor. And his main work is one of holiness and righteousness. He was also talking about his teaching being something that really stretched people. They would have to change in order to grasp it. And this would require some readiness to learn and adapt. I see it like manual handling for your mind. In manual handling, you need to get a firm grip on the load. Mental handling is where you get a new and firm hold on the truth. You don't throw away the truth. In Scripture, Jesus says in John chapter 16, 12 to 14, you can't bear these truths now, but the Holy Spirit will guide you into them later. And I'm praying that the Holy Spirit will help me and help us all to see this truth. But before this passage, Jesus was teaching and preaching. Then, just as Jesus is talking, behold, in some versions of the Bible, they don't have the word. It's idu in Greek or hidden in Hebrew. I don't guarantee my pronunciation. They miss it out. Anyway, it's there, a small word you can see 1,298 times in the Bible. It might be small, it's a big shame to miss it out. Behold, or else put it as look and learn, consider, perceive, know this, pay attention. I command you to watch this, watch it, gaze at this, give this your full undivided attention. Don't be looking at your phone. Don't be distracted by the patterned mask that someone else is wearing, or the sound of your own tummy rumbling. This demands your full, complete concentration. If you don't hold something important, then you'll miss it. Don't multitask in your mind. If you try to multitask, you'll miss it. Even a juggler isn't multitasking. He or she is concentrating on the task of looking. So just in other words, behold. Behold, a ruler is coming. He kneels before Jesus and speaks. But wait a minute, hold on. He kneels. He actually falls down on his knees, spreads himself out before Jesus. He's spread out in public. Is that a mark of respect we hear a lot about? Kneeling is a big thing, after all. Well, his head is probably touching the floor, and the head bows, is bowed in total reverence because someone who is more important than him is before him. Put it that way, it looks a lot and sounds a lot like an act of adoration. It's another Greek word, proskuneo. It means to kiss forward, do reverence, bow down before. It's in Hebrew, shaka, deep submission, bowing down, worship. This ruler was a synagogue boss. Another word for his job was top man, the highest ranking Jewish man in the town of Capernaum. And his role was important. He ran the synagogue there. I wonder if he knew that he was meeting the one who is Lord of history, is running time, the universe and everything. Jesus lived in that town. It said earlier, that was his city, Jesus' city. And Jesus often spoke in that synagogue. In a small town of 1,500 people, well short of the population of Greetham, that was the only synagogue in town. When Jesus spoke in one synagogue, his home one, they got so mad and angry that they tried to kill him by shoving them, running them out of town and over a cliff. And Jesus had lived in Capernaum for several years. He lived there for several years. It was his base, and where many of the miracles were done. And that was a town which should have understood Jesus, got hold of him, who he was, if any town did. But it didn't. And Jesus said that it's people who had missed their chance there, had missed him, and were cursed despite every advantage, despite every opportunity. If they didn't believe, they would bitterly regret it later. What would Jesus have to say about our town in England, with all our opportunities and all the privileges of our history to learn about and know Jesus? But anyway, this leader of the synagogue, having heard Jesus speak and heard and seen his work, came and he bowed down before him. So what? You say, if you're Jewish or you don't believe anything about this, you won't think much of it. He just sort of bowed in respect for a teacher or what seemed to be a prophet, maybe. But certainly not the promised Messiah, and certainly not an act of outright worship. Our Bible has a lot to say about worship. At the start of this book of Matthew, we have Matthew chapter 2, verse 11, Jesus being worshipped as a child with gold, frankincense, and myrrh, a sign that he would live and die and pray as the king of the whole earth. When on occasion people bowed down before someone, they were usually told, don't do it. Whether they were bound to men or angels. And in Matthew chapter 4, Jesus tells Satan that no one is to be worshipped but God. And that's Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 13. Because there are limits to respect. When respect and honor stop, and adoration and worship even begins. And only God can see whether someone's actions are worship or not. People were sacrificing. People sing. You think, that's worship. Well, God knows whether it's worship or not. And this ruler says, my daughter has just died. And the ruler's name is Jairus. In the Mark account, it says that his daughter was at the point of death. People came and told him that his daughter had died while he was speaking. And Luke says that his daughter was dying, and then people told him that she had died. So if Jesus was going to do anything now, it would have to be someone that would be raised from the dead. And who in all of history had ever raised anyone from the dead? Well, Elijah had once, and Elisha had once, and then another time after someone who was dead fell on Elisha's bones. Was Jesus at the very least in the same class as these? Maybe even greater. He had already raised someone from death. One of the tests of a Jewish Messiah would be that he would raise people from death. Jairus might have had that kind of faith in the Messiah then. He says that he believes Jesus to be capable of touching his dead 12-year-old daughter, his only daughter, and raising her to life. On what basis? Had that happened before? Way back in the history of Israel, Abraham had that God-given faith where he said, if I have to kill my son, God will raise him up. God will provide. Abraham, the father of faith, so that kneeling, spreading himself prostrate before Jesus and expecting him to raise someone from the dead, to me that looks a lot like worship and faith. So Jesus rose up and followed Jairus home with his disciples, and there was a huge crowd as well. And then Jairus is interrupted again, having interrupted Jesus earlier. Again it says, behold, someone had just jumped the queue for Jesus. But Jesus says, don't panic. Don't panic, Jairus. Don't be afraid. Hold on and believe. Jesus sees this scene of a woman touching his garment in faith. No one else noticed it. She touched his clothes from behind in a huge mass of people. The woman thought that she just had to touch Jesus' clothes to be healed. She said that in her insight. Now, where is that from? Is that a desperate superstition? A desperate lunge? Where did that come from? What was the ground or the basis for it? And I've heard a lot of sermons suggesting it is because this woman was really, really so desperate that Jesus listened to her. I think there's a lot more than that. More than 400 years before this event took place, it had been recorded in the book of Malachi that someone amazing and powerful would rise with healing in his wings. It's a metaphor. Wings are used to cover and protect. The Old Testament closes with Malachi chapter 4, verse 2. It says, but unto you that fear my name shall the Son of Righteousness arise with healing in his wings. Jews believed that this was going to be the Messiah. And the Messiah's prayer shawl, or tallit, had four corners. A piece of cloth at four corners, just like every Jewish man's. If you touch one of the four corners of the Messiah's, though, you would be healed. There's one in the royal line of David who had said in Psalm 17, verse 8, hide me in the shadow of your wings. And Psalm 36, verse 7 said, when Jews put on the prayer shawl, said this, and the children of men take refuge in the shadow of your wings. Think about it. Does the sun have wings? It has extending rays when it rises up. It can remind you of wings, and they bring life and light. And God's promise is similar to the sun that he himself created. Someone, a person, who would rise with righteousness, healing, restoration, strength, and peace. In Deuteronomy 22, verse 12, and Numbers 15, verse 38, it says to the Jews, make tassels on the corners of the cloak you wear with a blue cord or a blue riband. In this way, you'll remember all the commands of the Lord. And this woman touched the fringe. It's called zitzit in Hebrew, or kraspidon in Greek. It's the same word. It's exactly the same word, which means the edge or the border or the corner. And the word is also used in Matthew 23, verse 5, of the people that made their kraspidon or tassels extra long for show. The color is some sort of shade of blue. It's a cord of blue. And do you remember in Ruth, where Ruth asked Boaz, David's great-great-grandfather, to spread the corner of his garment over her? The same word means wing. He spread his protective wings over her. And the wings speak of authority, all the protection, all the responsibility, all the identity of God. So the significance of this woman is that she was laying hold of God's promise. She wasn't grabbing for her healing. She was reaching out for God in faith. She Jonah didn't touch this tassel. She wasn't all desperate, as if Jesus responded to that. Later in Matthew, this is a spoiler alert for a few weeks in the future, Matthew 14, 34 to 36, same as Mark 6 and 56, it says that people were brought out in the squares, and as many people as touched that edge of Jesus' garment were healed. All of them. So think about this woman. That she, for 12 years, she had been hemorrhaging blood. She was in a lot of pain. She went to doctors. She spent all her money. The doctors made things worse. She suffered at their hands. Some of the treatments that she must have received were horrific. They didn't have any idea. And all at the same time, for all those 12 years, she was a non-person. She was shunned. You know, forget social distancing. She didn't exist really. She couldn't go to the synagogue. She couldn't touch anyone else for 12 years. And then suddenly, Jesus says, your faith has made you well. And she was physically healed. And all the other ways in which it's possible to heal, she was as well. This word, I don't know if anyone's going to know what this word is. No? If Brian Johnson had been here, he would have probably put his hand up. It's the word shalom. It's the word peace. It means total healing, physical, emotional, social, every way that's possible to be healed. That is the word, that is what Jesus was saying. It's the same word that sozo in Greek. Okay, next picture. Right, this, you see this picture? There's something wrong with that picture. Do you know what it is? I'm not asking you to tell me, just pick your hand up if you think you will. I'll talk to you afterwards. Well, it didn't happen like that, because the woman, because of her social isolation, she was not allowed in the synagogue, she wasn't allowed to touch anyone, because she was unclean. She followed the crowd of Jairus, Jesus, the disciples, the big crowd, and she would have been behind. And no one knew that she'd actually touched Jesus, you know, the kind of fringe, the tassel there. Only Jesus knew that. So it wasn't as if she was making a desperate lot of noise. She wasn't drawing attention to herself. Absolute opposite. But because of Jesus, and because of her faith, and because of the faith of Jairus, she was healed. And then she was reintroduced to the synagogue. I can guarantee that Jairus would never have forgotten that day. Okay, so then they come to take Jairus home. And they get to his home. And what does the Bible say there is? There is a great commotion, because there are professional mourners there already. Things have moved on fast. There is a lot of noise, a lot of music. And then there's this new crowd to add to it as well. But these were professional mourners. That's what they, and you can probably picture the scene. I wouldn't try and demonstrate, but you can imagine how much commotion there is. A lot of noise. And then, when Jesus said that, this woman, this 12-year-old woman, is only sleeping, they start laughing at him. So they've gone from all that commotion and noise, they start laughing and ridiculing. The very idea that the girl was sleeping and is going to get back up. And again, it's, is that an idea what these professional mourners were doing, all that noise and commotion? Is that your idea of how to get God's attention? It reminds me of Elijah. Elijah versus Baal, not Gareth Baal, but the prophets of Baal. They're all beating their breasts and cutting each other and trying to work themselves up. You don't need that to have faith. So Jesus gets everyone out except a few disciples, the parents and himself. And the girl basically, by the way, is a woman because she's 12 years old, and if you're Jewish, you become a woman the day after your 12th birthday. You are responsible. You're a woman. This dead woman, 12-year-old, Jesus lifts her up. And the first thing that she would have seen when she was waking up from being dead would have been Jesus holding her up, and she would have probably saw his clothes, his wings, if you think, rising up, and she would have risen up as well. And then Jesus arranged for her to get something to eat, because as I said, she is a woman, but she's a 12-year-old woman, and 12-year-olds get hungry. And the report of this went through all that district, despite Jesus' wish to preserve dignity and privacy. So there's the story. Two women, one is 12 years old, and she's dead. Another one had been as good as dead, socially dead, dead to, you know, the spiritual life, dead to touching people, having any sort of dead, you know, dead to lots of things for 12 years. And then there's a crowd, including those women mourning the dead. But there's another character. There's also God at work. God's at work there. I know Jesus is there, but God has been at work throughout the history of the Jewish people. He had given them scripture right throughout their history. He had foretold exactly, well, he foretold what the Messiah would be. He'd even arranged that all Jewish men had clothes that had wings. You know, every Jewish man was supposed to have a prayer shawl and a tassel on the corner of it. They all had wings. God had woven all these things together with everyone else's choices. God had produced the basis for their faith and their encouragement to that faith. So how do you touch God? You can't touch the edge of his garment, not physically. How do you get God's attention? How do you hold on to him? It's faith. You act upon your faith in God and his whole character, his whole counsel revealed in scripture. And you don't just grab the corner of his character that provides healing or benefit. You don't build yourself up in your desperate expectation and desperation. It's not volume. It's not frenetic activity similar to the professional mourners, because that's commotion. How can we hold on to the tassel on Jesus' garment? What would that mean? Well, garment, that garment is about prayer and submission to God's word. It's a garment that covers Jesus' shoulders. Scripture says the government's on his shoulders in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. He's got responsibility for the whole world. And he's one who's never confused, never disorganized, never a lawbreaker, never baffled by the complexity of events. He's never beaten. He's one who's always at peace. And he said that we can be clothed in the garments of salvation. It says, fear his name. Now the name was so holy that Jews wouldn't even say it. They would just refer to it as the name. Jesus said, that name that you say, the name, that's me. That's all about me. That's my name. So Jesus has a holy character. He's righteous. He's loving. He's patient. But you need to behold and get a complete hold of that name. And if you do fear his name, if you do reverence him, if you do worship him, and it's not just by singing, it's not by bowing down, it's but what's in your heart. You don't need to be desperate, but you do desperately need Jesus. And if you do know him, lay hold of him more and more. Like Paul says, it's not as if I've already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Now I'm aware that today is the Sabbath of Sabbaths. It's a very important day for Jews. It's the Day of Atonement for sins. It's Yom Kippur. And it begins at sunset this evening. There are Jews all over the world who have trusted in Jesus as the Messiah. And that's based on the Old Testament scriptures alone. Isaiah 26 verse 19 says, "Your dead will live." Later in Matthew chapter 11, Jesus is asking about, when John's asking about the Messiah, Jesus says, "Go tell what you've seen. The dead are raised. Lepers are cleansed." Although this woman hemorrhaging blood wasn't really a leper, she was the nearest thing to it. That's in Isaiah chapter 35. It talks about the day of salvation. Because the Messiah would be God. The Messiah has a kingdom that never ends. He rules the whole earth. He is mighty. He is the eternal Father. We sin, we are sinners. A day of atonement happens so that sin is symbolically taken away. But that points towards the day when Jesus made a one-time sacrifice for sin. It says in Hebrews, another quite Jewish book in the Bible, that Jesus died once, one time only, for sin. So don't get yourself more desperate. Build up your faith in the one who is righteousness, the pure one, the one who makes full provision for your number one desperate priority of shalom, of righteousness, of salvation. Behold him today. When you saw the wings of that aeroplane, that symbolized something. When you see the cross, that is an instrument of death, but it means the symbolic of the life that Jesus has. So, behold. Behold him who he is, and your faith will be built up. Shall we pray? Lord God, you are the Lord of history, and you saw this day, you see every day. Not only do you combine three things together, you have the responsibility, it's on your shoulders to bring everyone's choices and their consequences, all the billions of people. You knew that we'd be here today. You knew what we'll do tomorrow. God, give us eyes to see and to build up faith in you, to look at you and so we will be especially healed from sin and all its consequences. I think we'll have one more song now.